Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. My name is Fredrik Albritton Jonsson. I'm a faculty member here in the History Department and CHSS, the History of Science program at the University of Chicago. It brings me great pleasure to welcome you, colleagues, friends, and students, to this afternoon's panel entitled Energy Histories and Geographies. The panel will be moderated by my colleague Ryan Jobson, who will introduce the speakers. But before we get to Ryan, I'd like to say a few words about the context of this event. This is the product of a working group of faculty at the University of Chicago that are collaborating on a proposal to establish CEGU, the Committee on Environment, Geography, and Urbanization. I serve as one of the faculty organizers of this CEGU proposal. So I'll just say a few brief words about our work. We've been at it for nearly 1.5 years now. This event is the second panel in a series of four that together mark our first public engagement with the issues we hope to explore in the committee. So it's a moment of great excitement and joy to come together here. We are eager to dive into the substantive work of research and pedagogy that we'll pursue in years ahead. CEGU is a proposal that has been developed by a group of faculty in the Division of Social Sciences and the Division of Humanities and beyond. All of us concerned with questions of society and environment across space and time, especially in relation to the contemporary planetary emergencies associated with climate change and biodiversity loss. CEGU is envisioned as a robust interdisciplinary platform for social science and humanities research and pedagogy on such issues. We seek to investigate and respond to environmental crises of our time, not only by advancing climate change awareness and environmental literacy, but by actively centering questions about socio-environmental dynamics, conflicts, and crises in the knowledge formation that animate the social sciences and the humanities. In short, we aim at nothing less than renovating our approach to such issues in order to understand more adequately the proliferating environmental problems of our time. The CEGU faculty working group believes that such intellectual renovation is urgently important, not only for scholarly purposes, but also in relation to the most pressing practical problems of our moment. And the social consequences of these practical problems across the world. As we explore possible pathways away from our entrenched dependence upon fossil fuels, we need new frameworks of analysis to facilitate our understanding of our contemporary predicament, such that we can transcend it, hopefully towards a more environmentally sane form of collective social and political existence. We anticipate that CEGU will become a lively space of scholarly exchange, research, and pedagogical exploration for faculty and students and other allies to collaborate in wrestling with all these issues. CEGU bundles together many of the capacities that already exist within the social sciences and humanities, while also creating spaces for new capacities and deepening and extending them to face our challenges. And let me say just very briefly that we have two additional events planned for the spring as part of the same series, dealing with environment, democracy, and social movements. And that one is with Megan Black and Alyssa Battistoni. And the fourth panel is entitled Animals, Territories, and Environments. And that one is with Matthew Gandhi and Mindy Schneider. All of whom will be in dialogue with members of the CEGU faculty group. For more details about these events and registration, please go to our preliminary website, cegu.info, cegu.info. These panels are intended to open up questions and discussions about a vast intellectual terrain that we hope to explore in CEGU in years ahead. Our faculty working group is meanwhile further developing details of our proposal, including undergraduate pedagogy, a planned doctoral certificate, and other forms of graduate program, as well as agendas related to faculty research and public outreach. Our proposal will receive additional feedback from our colleagues at the University of Chicago during the months ahead. We'll make further announcements about future plans as soon as we are in position to do so. For students at the University of Chicago, let me mention that we'll be organizing some discussion groups shortly to share further details and solicit your feedback on new directions. Before starting the panel, a few words of thanks to all the faculty involved in the CEGU working group, and especially the interim chair of CEGU, Neil Brenner, and the CEGU executive committee members, Alan Collada, Sabina Shaikh, and Lisa Wadeen. And to our wonderful project and communications coordinator, Carlo Diaz. For support, advice, and encouragement at divisional and collegiate levels, thanks to Amanda Woodward, Dean of the Division of Social Sciences, Howard Nussbaum, Master of the Social Science Collegiate Division, and thanks to the GANS Fund, connected to the university's longstanding commitment to geographical studies. The GANS Fund is helping us cover the costs associated with a panel series. Now, let me turn our proceedings over to my wonderful and brilliant colleague, Professor Ryan Jobson, the Neubauer Family Assistant Professor of Anthropology here at the University of Chicago, who has been a collaborator on all aspects of CEGU since we began brainstorming about the idea 18 months ago. Ryan works at the intersection of sociocultural anthropology and African American studies. His research and teaching engage issues of energy and extractive resource development, technology and infrastructure, states and sovereignty, and not the least, histories of racial capital and racial capitalism in the colonial and post-colonial Americas. Broadly, his research examines the relationship between modern energy regimes and the modern political ideal of sovereignty. His first book manuscript, Deepwater Futures, Sovereignty at Risk in a Caribbean Petrostate, is an ethnographic study of fossil fuel industries and post-colonial state building in Trinidad and Tobago. Jobson is a faculty affiliate of the Center for the Study of Race, Politics, and Culture, the Center for Latin American Studies, the Committee on International Relations. He's also associate editor of the journal Transforming Anthropology and the editorial board of current Anthropology and Small Acts. Most recently, and this is the final thing I want to mention, most recently, Jobson has collaborated on a 2022-23 Neubauer Collegium project entitled Fossil Capital and the Global South, which he will coordinate with Liz Chatterjee and Victoria Saramago. Thanks again, everyone, for being here. Now, Ryan, over to you.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you, Fredrik, for that introduction. Again, I'm Ryan Jobson, and on behalf of the Faculty Working Group on Environment, Geography, and Urbanization, it's my distinct pleasure to moderate today's conversation on energy histories and geographies. And we do intend for this to be a conversation. So throughout today's event, as our guests engage in conversation with me as moderator, please feel free to use the raise hand function to add yourself to the queue. And we hope to have a robust Q&A portion at the conclusion of their remarks. With no further ado, our first guest, Thea Riofrancos, is an associate professor of political science at Providence College, an Andrew Carnegie Fellow, and a Radcliffe Institute Fellow. Her research focuses on resource extraction, renewable energy, climate change, green technology, social movements, and the left in Latin America. These themes are explored in her book, Resource Radicals, From Petronationalism to Post-Extractivism in Ecuador, which I've enjoyed teaching on many occasions. Her co-authored book, A Planet to Win, Why We Need a Green New Deal, and academic articles in World Politics, Perspectives on Politics, and Cultural Studies. Her writing has appeared in the New York Times, The Guardian, Boston Review, The Baffler, N Plus One, Dissent, and Jacobin, among many others. And she's currently at work on a book entitled Extraction, The Frontiers of Green Capitalism, under contract with W.W. Norton. So welcome, Thea. Our other guest this afternoon, Julie Klinger, is assistant professor in the Department of Geography and faculty in the Minerals, Materials, and Society program at the University of Delaware. She holds a PhD in geography from the University of California, Berkeley, and has conducted extensive ethnographic, qualitative, and quantitative fieldwork over the past 15 years on the dynamics of global resource frontiers and space-based technologies in China, Brazil, and the United States. Her research examines how diverse forms of violence and strategies for survival shape land use, environmental conservation, and livelihood security. Her 2017 book, Rare Earth Frontiers, From Terrestrial Subsoils to Lunar Landscapes, examines the global geography of rare earth prospecting and mining, and was awarded the Meridian Book Prize from the American Association of Geographers. In the years since, Professor Klinger has advanced her research agenda in three broad thematic areas: critical mineral supply chains, global space politics, and community survival strategies. And welcome, Julie. So today we're gathered under the heading of Energy Histories and Geographies, which I first must admit, when I was asked to moderate this conversation, I balked at the kind of vast and seemingly impenetrable nature of these three keywords, because after all, energy, history, and geography intersect with most every sort of empirical site or methodological approach or disciplinary tradition. So I was very much at a loss over where to begin. So thank you, Thea and Julie, for your patience as I sorted that out. But in order to begin our conversation, I just wanted to take a brief moment to reflect on two relatively recent moments where I think the conjunction of energies, histories, and geographies unceremoniously converged. The first is at the outset of the COVID-19 pandemic in North America in April 2020, when the precipitous drop in demand for crude oil and the absence of excess storage facilities turned spot prices for oil negative. The second, and I think more immediate to today's conversation, is the military incursion of Russian forces in Ukraine has prompted speculation in oil futures markets, with markets topping $90 a barrel as traders anticipate sanctions and supply chain disruptions. In both cases, mainstream media outlets have often reduced these very complex historical and geographical contingencies of energy sources, infrastructures, and geopolitics to instrumental considerations of its impact on consumers. For instance, low prices at the pump in April 2020, skyrocketing prices at the pump today, or in the context of energy-dependent petrostates, such as my own research sites in Trinidad and Guyana, as a hindrance to multinational investment at the peak of COVID-19 during the bear market, and military conflict in Eastern Europe as a potential boon to future upstream exploration and production. So as our conversation unfolds this afternoon, I hope we can attend to this very common mystification in which, you know, energy is distressingly extracted from its constitutive histories and geographies, and often to violent effects. And I'm thrilled to be here with our guests today based on your spectacular work. And I might open by asking, in your respective careers, your research on energy, extractivism, mining covers an expansive geography that includes oil and mining in Ecuador, lithium in Chile, rare earth elements in Inner Mongolia, Brazil, and the moon, among many others. Tell us how you arrived at the specific sites and geographies you examine in your work. You know, what do we learn from studying not simply the technical properties of energy resources, but the geographies they're extracted from? And we can begin in any order.
I'll jump in, and thank you for this question, which I love, and I'm going to take it pretty literally. You asked, like, how did we arrive at these field sites? And I want to talk a bit for a moment about the trajectory that led me to first study resource extraction in Ecuador. And what I want to emphasize is its serendipity, in part because I think that this is something really effaced in textbooks and, you know, sort of methodology handbooks that often graduate students read or undergrads read that talk to you about case selection. I'm a political scientist, right? So this is language that's very familiar to me. And I think they kind of don't really attend to the ways that scholars encounter their own interests, their own commitments, and the specific places that they end up working. So in my case, the decision to select Ecuador as a case was not that at all. It was a decision to move to Ecuador before I was a graduate student, not just before I was a graduate student, before I knew I was going to be a graduate student. I'd applied to grad school and then my partner and I left and went to Latin America. So I had really, my future was wide open. But we arrived in Ecuador in 2008, intentionally to sort of witness and be involved in a sort of solidarity capacity in this really momentous moment in Latin American history, which was a left-wing government had just been elected in Ecuador. The same thing had happened in tons of neighboring countries. This is called the Pink Tide by scholars and other observers. And we wanted to witness firsthand what it looked like to for movements that had kind of demanded for the left to come to power, for them to actually experience what it's like to live under a left-wing government. And so we wanted to see that firsthand. And so we went there. And as soon as I arrived, really basically as soon as I arrived and we started talking to activists of local movements, I realized that this issue of resource extraction and of indigenous rights, which are very closely connected issues, of course, was going to be contentious and divisive within the left. That the left that had recently come to power, and I know we'll maybe talk about this topic of the left in power and extraction a bit later, but that had recently come to power would find its sort of broader left coalition riven by the issue of extraction, indigenous rights and territory, which are issues that, you know, we can date the origins of those as political arenas to colonialism, right? So they have really long histories, but they're also intensely charged in the present. And sort of encountering that really drew me in. And then much later, I ended up writing a dissertation and then a book on that topic, right? But just, you know, again, to give a sense of the serendipity, I'll just say one or two other brief things that serendipity continues to be like a site selection method for me. So just to kind of expand on this theme, but bring it to the present with my work on lithium, that work started in Latin America, because as you can sort of tell, I'm someone that's researched Latin America and lived in Latin America and a family there. And, you know, so it's like a very close place to me. But I ended up, so I did field work in Chile, which I'll talk maybe a little bit more about later, on the lithium sector there, starting in 2019. Totally unexpectedly, and actually just a couple months before the pandemic arrived in Europe, I went to a conference in Brussels. I was invited to go to a conference on the Green New Deal, something else we might talk about. And I sort of had been keeping track through my Google News alert that like EU officials were really interested in lithium and really interested in battery supply chains. So I thought, I've never studied the EU before. Not only that, but I'm someone that has often criticized like academics that just fly into places that they don't know a lot about and do like short field work stints. But I was like, I'm here, the carbon is being emitted by this plane, I might as well take advantage. And so I set up some interviews with EU commissioners, and in that moment, my mind exploded that like lithium was not just a story of extractivism in Latin America, which it is. It's also a story of the shifting geopolitics, of the return of industrial policy, of something scholars call geoeconomics, which is like a geopolitical frame to look at economic sectors. And I just realized that this is also a story about the global north and about where these supply chains end up. And so that, again, serendipitous kind of encounter reframed my whole project to one that now is transnational in its scope rather than just Chile or Latin America specific. But just as an opening gambit, I want to sort of emphasize that that serendipity piece. I have a few other thoughts on this question, but I want to just turn it right away over to Julie. And then, you know, if there's time, I can say more, or if not, you know, we can move on to other points.
All right, thank you. Thank you for that opening question. And I think it's a really good one, particularly, you know, when we're speaking to audiences that contain undergraduate and graduate students and people who, and beyond, you know, people who are perhaps, you know, because of the circumstances surrounding the COVID-19 pandemic, there's a lot of deep reflection happening around the kind of research that we do and what it means and all of this. So, you know, to add to Thea's point about the importance of serendipity, I'll also say that, you know, I literally arrived at the places, with the exception of the moon and outer space, where I do my research, simply by following the questions. You know, I come from I was born and raised not too far from University of Chicago, outside of Rockford, big, you know, 3-4 generation farming family. And in the early 2000s, we started to run into trouble because the prices for soybeans was tanking. We're trying to figure out why. And it turns out that one of the primary causes was the rapid expansion of agribusiness interests in Brazil. And this expansion was so dramatic that farmers were actually leaving Illinois to buy land in Brazil and to continue farming there so they could export to China. And so I thought, well, isn't this interesting? And so I thought that I'd follow the question to see what was happening between Brazil and China that was touching down home, in Illinois. I came across this question, came upon this question as an undergraduate student. Crucial context, I had lived in Brazil for a year prior to college as an exchange student, was fluent in Portuguese. I then took a year off after my first year of college to live in China to learn Mandarin. So I had the languages to help with that. In continuing to follow the question of these global dynamics of trade, commodity flows, land use change, and what that actually means for people on the ground, that's what eventually took me to, or brought me to, the rare earth frontier in all of its different places, whether it's in Inner Mongolia or the Brazilian Amazon or Southern California or elsewhere, Afghanistan, Greenland, Australia, Malaysia, the deep ocean, outer space. Again, I haven't been to the deep ocean or outer space, but I guess I'll just sum up there to say, there's no substitute for being in the field. And there's really, I haven't found in my life or my work any suitable alternative for following the questions wherever they may lead you. And if you find yourself in a situation, like I have many times, where you don't have some basic tools that allow you to pursue the questions where they're leading you, like language or things like that, or, you know, the ability to, climb mountains carrying certain things in certain temperatures and all of this stuff, you invest in the training. I think that's the privilege and the commitment of a researcher's life, is this sort of figuring out what you need to do in order to invest in the training to allow you to ask the questions that aren't being asked. I'll say, like, over about a decade, I spent 5 years living and working in China, and in the same decade of the early 2000s until about 2013, 2014, I spent about 3 of those years in Brazil. And so it's through deep roots to these places that you can investigate the multi-scalar dynamics of energy geographies and history, and not just get the policy speak, but really spend time in the landscapes that are altered by them, and to spend time with the people whose lives and whose bodies bear the burden of our global energy geographies.
That's fantastic. And thank you both for sort of sharing those serendipitous moments that both sort of occur in the process of field work, as well as the process of writing up these various projects. I really do appreciate, and perhaps you can return to the question of serendipity as method. And I'm also thinking, Julie, in your sort of defense of empirical or long-term fieldwork, of sort of Zora Neale Hurston's euphemism of ethnography, where she says, you know, you have to go there to know there. There's something very different about actually dwelling in the geographies in which, you know, certain modes of raw materials and energy sources are extracted, and then being able to know and map those geographies quite effectively in our work. So I'm wondering if, on that note, if we might pivot to sort of questions of climate, and particularly the way that, you know, much of the climate justice movement in the global north is centered on reducing dependence on fossil fuels, the promotion of renewable energy technologies, particularly wind and solar. Yet, as both of you sort of detail in your research, renewables themselves carry massive environmental and social costs in the form of mining projects, the displacement of local and indigenous communities. So how does an attention to these geographies perhaps temper optimism about the promise of renewables?
how can we ensure a transition away from fossil fuels that's both responsible and just? And you have, you know, 5 minutes to figure out this entire problem. So thank you.
Go for it, Thea.
Sure. So I like this question a lot. And because I you know, work a lot in between the two spaces that you're kind of indicating in terms of, you know, I consider myself, you know, a global north-based climate advocate and someone who is unabashedly in favor of, you know, an ambitious policy proposal like the Green New Deal. Yet I also spend a lot of time and have a lot of colleagues and comrades in the places affected by extraction, which I want to just underscore because I think there also is a tendency sometimes to exoticize extraction as something that happens elsewhere. It's already come up in our you know, just initial foray, but extraction happens in the global north, right? We need to look no further than the fracking boom, but also because of the critical and strategic nature, as in the words of states, of some of these minerals, there's sometimes an effort to actually onshore and bring extraction closer to home, right? So it's not just about extraction elsewhere in solidarity with other and different people, it's about a sort of planetary phenomena. But that little piece of context aside, so, you know, you use the word temper optimism, and I think it's very apt, but I feel torn in responding to it. Because I think on the one hand, I want, maybe optimism is not the right word, but I want people to feel motivated about joining collective movements to put pressure on policymakers. And I'm wary of tempering any positive feelings that they might have about those political commitments, because I'm actually worried that we're entering into a moment of a lot of political nihilism, cynicism, that is much more fertile ground for right-wing and even scarier kind of fascist kind of movements to take hold, right? So on the one hand, I want people to hold on to their kind of beliefs in the possibility of positive transformation. On the other hand, I think it's apt because what I think I do want to temper optimism in is the idea that there is a technological fix to a problem that is deeper than technological choices, right? But also inflects those technological choices. So just to sort of say it maybe more simply, that energy systems are embedded and interact with all these other social systems with all of their inequalities and oppressions and marginalizations, right? So thinking that you can isolate the technology, whether it's a solar panel or a wind turbine or the, you know, the underlying, you know, energy that just swap in one energy source from another without touching the systems and hierarchies that they interact with feels very insufficient to me on justice grounds, on moral and ethical grounds, in terms of, you know, what the stakes of the crisis are. So I think that's one way to think about it. Not that we shouldn't change technologies or deploy green technologies or change our energy sources, but that doing that in a way that isolates them from broader social environmental landscapes is going to reproduce existing inequalities and actually encode them into the materiality of the new energy system that we're in the process of building. And I'll just mention one other quick thing here. You know, the other thing that I think that a sort of planetary or global view helps with is to realize that what happens in extractive landscapes, which again can be in the global north or the global south, though they are disproportionately in the global south for sure, especially the most toxic and harmful ones, that what happens in those landscapes is not isolated. It's not like, you know, those governments or people have made some error in like choosing to submit themselves to social and environmental harm, right? There's a long history as to why certain places are designated as sacrifice zones and other places are not. So we could get into that. But also even without the historical view, just with like a conjunctural snapshot, all of the decisions that happen, as it's called, downstream from extraction, you know, the choices that car companies or turbine companies make about what resources they're going to use and how they're going to produce things, the choices that governments make about how to design the energy transition through policy, all of that kind of reverberates backwards to the extractive frontier and helps or is part of shaping how violent those frontiers are, how extractive they are, right? How much local people benefit or don't from what happens there. So, and then, you know, the last thing I'll say here is that that also works in the other direction, right? Because I want to retain the agency of the extractive frontier and the dynamics that are specific to it. So protest at a mine in Chile is also going to reverberate down the supply chain in the other direction, right? And the tighter and tenser and more geopolitically strategic supply chains are, the more these dynamics reverberate, right? The more that what happens in one place affects another. And I think, you know, regardless of your selection of sites, if you have that kind of slightly meta perspective and can have that dialogue between the specific and the global, you can, I think, see those interconnections. Maybe that went a little afield of the question, but yeah, I think I don't want to restrain people's optimism for the possibility of transformation, but more grounded in the materiality of, you know, the extractive foundations of the energy transition.
Yeah, I've been thinking a lot about where we are, you know, the rock and the hard place between sort of techno-optimism, cornucopianism that remarkably still exists, but also political nihilism and a kind of right-wing nationalist nostalgia. And it's a couple of different rocks and a couple of different hard places. But in thinking through how to talk about this, I prepared some images to kind of help us think with storybook style, right? These are heavy things. And so I find that, you know, storybook type images can maybe help us think with a little bit more clarity and help us come closer to what it is that we want to talk about. So I'll just share my screen here. And so, you know, looking at this generic image of a beautiful green field, I think that, you know, if you're a techno-optimist, this is what we can have, right? We can have this, and we can have all of our great technologies and boundless energy and all of this. And, you know, if you are a sort of right-wing nationalist nostalgic person, who was thinking about or experiencing pollution, environmental degradation, or all of this, which is an interesting and I think more common than generally realized, a cross-section of identities and affective experiences. It's about sending that extractive or polluting things elsewhere so that we can have this at home, right? Something like this. And, you know, if you're sort of well-meaning, individual who cares about climate change, right? Many of us love these kinds of landscapes. And so we think, okay, well, if the problem, the cause of environmental degradation is, you know, fossil fuel emissions, then all we really need to do, right, and being simplistic for the sake of time, all we need to do is replace this with this, right? And if you do that long enough and often enough, eventually you restore the landscape, everything's beautiful again. And in fact, right, if we don't challenge the status quo, right, boundless energy, all of this thing, the more, the better, and we're all super duper happy and everything's great. But of course, these renewable energies, they do have a geography, their supply chains have geographies, right? This is an image of a rare earth mine in Southern California. By and large, as far as large scale mines go, a environmentally responsible operation, it nevertheless does involve the annihilation of specific landscapes and lifeways of human and non-human others. This is a tailings pond of a outside the world's largest rare earth mine in Bayan Obo in Inner Mongolia in China. And the juxtaposition here of the tailings pond in this apocalyptic landscape with wind turbines rising in the background, right? Because this is part of the vertically integrated industrial landscape from mine to finished product, which many proponents of onshoring are idealizing as well. This is maybe not exactly what we have in mind, but this is what's happening, right? And I think it's fueled by our techno-optimism. And then, of course, there's the question of what we do with these technologies when they reach the end of their lives, right? This is a very compelling drone photograph of a burial ground for fiberglass wind turbine blades in Wyoming. They can't be recycled, right? And so the question here then is, you know, if we are concerned about this in the context of renewable energy generation, we can very easily fall into this discourse that clean energy has a dirty little secret, right? And we can be paralyzed And we might just throw up our hands and say, well, you know, we're damned if we do and we're damned if we don't. But actually, and this is where I think the critical consciousness and climate consciousness is important, every major form of energy generation, right, whether it's nuclear, fossil, big hydropower, and renewable, relies to some extent on the rare earth elements that I study and the other ancillary materials, metals, fiberglass, and that sort of thing that are such a big issue. And so maybe instead of tempering optimism, we might channel the passion to look again empirically at the facts of our status quo, that maybe our real dirty little secret is in fact the status quo, right? Which is basically characterized by this, you know, in order to build out the renewable energy transition, according to business as usual, we're going to go dig a big hole somewhere new. We'll create a massive waste footprint. And then we'll build a trash mountain of our disposed technologies and infrastructures, but not in my backyard, right? Which is, and that geography of not in my backyard, of course, rides on historical and contemporary processes of oppression, discrimination, and environmental injustice. But here's the key thing, and I think this is our conundrum, whether you're talking about rare earth elements or something else, The elements of our renewable energy transition are not like fossil fuels fundamentally and materially in that they don't evaporate into the air once we finish using them, right? The elements of our energy transition or any other energy scenario, right, with the exception of fossil fueled energies, they're here. They remain with us. It's just we transmogrify them into this thing that we can no longer access called waste. And I would say that maybe that's the challenge. But unfortunately, waste is not quite as sexy as digging a big hole and putting up a big field of new wind turbines. And so I think that's really our challenge here, is reorienting our gaze to exactly where the opportunities lie in a way that's cognizant of historical and ongoing patterns of oppression, destruction, and discrimination to ensure that we don't reproduce them. I'll stop there.
Thank you for that really stunning visualization, Julie. And thank you both for your attention to my very ambitious and perhaps unfair question. So I feel very much re-energized and perhaps re-optimized by this, this dialogue. Before I move on, I do want to remind our audience that at any point you can use the raise hand function to add yourself to the queue. And we do anticipate a very sort of robust Q&A session toward the end of our event today. But I might pose the next question directly to Thea, that in your answer, you sort of raised a familiar dilemma that I know sort of occurs in my own research context, where the sort of perils of transitioning away from an economy that is dependent on fossil fuels, and particularly in Trinidad and in the Caribbean, that also lies on the front lines of sort of the climate crisis in the region, sea level rise, increasing intensity and frequency of hurricanes. This transition can be particularly daunting for petrostates in the global south, where extractive windfalls have formed the basis of social democratic reforms, while also deepening circuits of indigenous dispossession and environmental devastation. So, Thea, in your previous research on the pink tide in Latin America and Ecuador in particular, this of late has actually led to a very clear split between the neo-extractive and anti-extractive factions of the political left. So broadly, as working people rally for social democratic reforms throughout the Americas and globally, what lessons can be drawn from the case of Ecuador and I guess many of its regional compatriots?
Yeah, this is such a good moment to ask this question for precisely the reason you said at the end there, which is that a bunch of left-wing governments have recently or are coming to power in Latin America again, to the point where some observers are asking, like, is this another pink tide? Especially because we haven't had the elections yet in Colombia or Brazil, but left-wing candidates are looking promising there as well, right? And you know, there's a couple of different lessons I could draw out here. I want to just mention a quick thing about Chile because it pertains so much to our topics, and then I'll maybe broaden out a little bit, which is that in Chile, a left-wing former student activist, a young person younger than me and the youngest president ever in Chile, is coming to power in a few weeks and on March 11th, right, after a really conservative right-wing presidential administration. So it's a huge change Meanwhile, they're rewriting their constitution, which has a lot of implications for natural resource governance. They may, for example, decide to respect the rights of nature in their constitution, making them the second constitution to do so after Ecuador. So there's a lot of changes afoot, but I want to just dramatize this tension between these two different left inclinations around extraction in Gabriel Boric, who is the incoming president, in his own platform. So on the one hand, he has promised to establish a state-owned lithium company with the idea that this will enable Chile and Chileans to benefit more from lithium extraction than they have, and to not have all the profits go outside of the country, but to retain some of that economic benefit within the country. So he's promised that. He has also promised no more sacrifice zones, which is common activist language in Chile, right? To refer to places harmed by extraction. Are these two compatible? They could be. It could be coherent to say if the state's more involved, the regulation could be better. The record is not always that way with state-owned extractive companies though, right? Including in Chile, where there's a huge state-owned copper company that doesn't have the best track record. So I just want to note that this is like this, the tension between these two different, like a sort of resource nationalist and a anti-extractivist left, reverberate in the current moment of transition and also, you know, across national contexts. Let me just say one or two other things about your question. I think if I wanted to generalize it as much as possible and even take it out of extraction for a moment, just like, what does this divide among the Ecuadorian left teach us about progressive political projects in general, wherever they take place? And I think, you know, one of the things that I learned is that and now really believe is that the hardest part of left, progressive, transformative, emancipatory, whatever word we want to use, political projects begins when you arrive at power. I think it's easy to think that the hardest thing is getting into power, because it is very hard. You have many cards stacked against you. But it is even harder, and I think every history of every revolution kind of attests to this, right? When the revolution wins, that's like the beginning of the saga of splits in the coalition, of, you know, infighting. And so this is in some ways a familiar story, but I think being intentional and knowing about that before the arrival to power is helpful, perhaps. And then one sort of final point that gets more to your question about transition, about transitions from extractive to post-extractive models of development in the global South, which is a demand of movements, but also has been a promise of governments, still, you know, a very deferred promise of progressive governments. So another thing that I learned, and actually I feel like I learned this lesson after I wrote my book, so I almost wish I had this more present in the book, which is just maybe a very basic point, but that the, especially in the global South, that the nation state, the sort of bounded national unit and its government, is very ill-suited, a very ill-suited container for addressing the legacy of extractivism and transitioning and transforming out of it, right? There are so many constraints on a state like Ecuador in terms of the global political economy, and also domestic ruling class and elites, that make it, you know, very difficult for a government that even wants to, that has the intentions of embarking on that transition, to do so. And so I've started to think about, like, what would, you know, something like a new international economic order, and I'm really drawing on the work of a, you know, U of Chicago professor, Adam Getachew, who has an amazing book on this, right? What would like a new international economic order for the 21st century look like? Like, what would it look like to regionally coordinate across progressive governments in the global South to say, we're not going to pay these onerous sovereign debts anymore. We're going to invest in our societies. And also, global North, can you pay us the billions of dollars you've promised for climate finance, which you still haven't paid, right? And so, you know, and maybe even something more ambitious, like what would reparations look like at a global scale, right? Drawing on Femi Taiwo's recent book. So, you know, but none of that is possible without transnational coordination from below, from global South governments and movements. And so just kind of thinking beyond the nation state seems to me an imperative, especially in this moment of energy transition where global South petrostates will be, as you say, really left behind without revenues to address basic needs. So I'll leave it there, but that's where my mind has been at with this question recently.
And again, thank you for, again, thinking through the limits of the nation state methodologically and analytically. I think this is so crucial to the way that we can apprehend, you know, energy histories across the Americas and globally. And also I wanted to thank you for sort of putting a pin in the question of seizing power and then we might say redistributing power, because I happen to be teaching my undergrads, and I believe a few of them are in the audience today, about Grenada. And of course, I wasn't alive during the US invasion of Grenada, and certainly neither were my undergraduate students. So it's so helpful to think about how, again, these sort of histories reverberate and how they intersect with the governance of any energy resources. So in the interest of thinking beyond sort of an instrumental consideration of the nation state, I might pose the next question to Julie. And Julie, in your research, you demonstrate how the push to secure rare earth minerals for green energy technologies continues to stoke geopolitical tensions between nation states. And I'm quoting here where you say, as Americans of all ideological stripes project their anxieties about China onto the rare earths and the rare earth minerals in China. So what measures can be taken to prevent the transition to renewables from exploding into much the same conflicts over energy resources that pervaded the 20th and early 21st centuries, and quite unsettlingly into this week? So thank you, Julie.
Yeah, thanks for the question. I think it's a timely one. I mean, when I was doing this research at the beginning of the decade for this part in particular, around, you know, the US responses to its sort of popular or collective awakening to the geography of our global supply chains, and the fact that most rare earth mining happened and processing had happened to concentrate in China, not as a result of accident entirely, and not also as a result of conspiracy on the part of China, but rather this was the result of two very complementary policy approaches between China and the US coming together in the 1980s and onward, right? So China was opening and attracting certain kinds of industrial investment, and the US was looking to offshore its more polluting, energy-intensive industries, mining and rare earth processing and magnet manufacturing among them, right? And so at the time, offshoring this stuff from the US sort of mainstream political perspective was both patriotic and environmental, right? Because it was, you know, promoting American values abroad through free trade and, you know, maximum efficiency and comparative advantage and all of this, and while also protecting America the beautiful, right? And so in the discourse that has unfolded around rare earths in China over the past decade or so, that piece has completely dropped out. And what we have instead is a sort of ahistorical conspiracy theory narrative that that positions our or frames our global rare earth geographies and industrial and extractive geographies as a matter of sort of like a conspiracy commanded from Beijing or something. And this has really become a regular feature in myth-making in popular culture. I'll just show one image here, just to give you a sense of the extent of the way that this myth has sort of permeated, or the idea of China using rare earths to sort of hold the rest of the world hostage, has really permeated a lot of different venues of popular culture, including in first-person shooter video games. It's been plot devices in TV shows and in many, many novels. And so to your question, you know, what measures can be taken to prevent renewables from exploding into the same conflict over energy resources? We have to take seriously the fact that this is a prevalent trope in these sites of popular culture and myth making. I think that's the first thing. The second thing I'll say actually has to do, it's a little bit broader, has to do with some fundamentals in approaches to economics, right? So, okay, let's say that something fundamentally does need to change in the industrial and extractive geographies of rare earth elements between the US and China. We've heard a lot of talk about this over the past decade or so, and it periodically comes and goes as like a headline grabbing thing. in the media, but, and there have been dozens of legislative proposals to try and somehow onshore or reinvigorate rare earth manufacturing in the US. And some of them have gotten traction, most have not. And I think this has to do with the fact that when it comes to resource acquisition, the dominant economic model coming out of the US and the dominant economic model coming out of China are fundamentally different, right? So, you know, with the US, it's free market, sink or swim, be profitable or go out of business. And for all of our talk about the importance of onshoring the rare earth industry, this is still predominantly the approach, right? Sink or swim, figure it out. Whereas China's dominant economic doctrine is much more focused around the utility of the minerals, right? So to use Marxist political theory, what we're looking at is a difference between emphasizing exchange value on the part of the US and emphasizing use value on the part of China, right? Where it's the priority is not quarterly profits or even year to year or annual returns, although state-owned enterprises are profit motivated and do need to remain solvent. Rather, the overarching priority is to maintain a steady global supply of rare earth elements and other strategic materials, precisely in order to avoid the kinds of oil-related conflicts that we saw in the 20th century. And so these are facts that are pretty plain as day, but they can be very difficult to see or come to terms with if we have our ideological blinders on. Right. And often for even talking about this, right, and speaking from my my expertise in Chinese economic theory and practice, even here in the US, I'm often then misread as apologizing for or defending the Chinese government, which is simply not the case. Right. So I think that our challenge is daunting. The final thing that I will say too is that this is bigger than a US and China thing. If you look at a map of the USGS maps, the US Geological Survey's maps of where so-called critical material endowments are located, and then you look at and you overlay that with a map of indigenous lands, current and ancestral, you'll see a pretty neat overlap. And so the other thing that we have to keep in mind is what exactly do our extractive geographies look like if we take seriously the proviso that we can no longer presume access to indigenous lands? So there's the US-China piece, but then if onshoring is the alternative, then we do have to really grapple with the indigenous lands piece as well.
I may pose just one final question that sort of takes up this this sort of figure of onshoring. So, you know, together the energy histories that both of you have charted for us quite brilliantly and evocatively demonstrate the limits of insular, you know, nationalist or nation-bounded solutions to climate change. For instance, onshoring mineral production from the global south to the global north, or even the Green New Deal, which in some instances reproduces a kind of America first approach to a renewable energy transition. So as a sort of final provocation, sort of what would it require for a Green New Deal or other kinds of legislative measures and policies to enact a sort of hemispheric or global compact for climate justice? I will just leave it there. And again, anyone who would like to add their name to the Q&A, please refer to the raise hand function.
So I mean, what I'm about to say, I think resonates so much with Julie, which is not a coincidence because Julie's work has influenced me so much. And also I think we think alike in many ways. So there'll be some repetition maybe, but hopefully it's helpful in terms of, I think, our critique of onshoring, which is especially in Julie's work, like also a historical critique, right? Of like, why did things end up where they are, right? The story is actually not that simple, but also then just bringing them back is also, you know, has its own nostalgic kind of, and even also reactionary sometimes valences to it. But I want to kind of underline something in the question, which is that this idea that in order to compete with, quote, Chinese dominance, we in the global north need to recite these supply chains from beginning, from their toxic extractive beginnings, all the way to their more value added kind of processes, need to recite them within our borders. It's something I've had my eyes on for a little while now, and it is just going to, I think, gain more momentum. So I think it's just something for us as critical thinkers, as activists, as scholars, however we identify, to kind of keep our eye on, because I think it is a hard narrative actually for progressives to have adequate responses to, for a key reason in terms of how this narrative is framed, which is that it's often claimed that, and this is almost right where Julie left off with her prior comment, it's often framed that doing anything, including mining, in the global north is more responsible, sustainable, secure, and even ethical, right? That like we do it better than they do it. They is China, or they is like former, you know, colonies in the global south or whatever it is, right? Okay. And so how do you respond to this? Like, is it true? It can feel appealing almost. Like, we know that, and there's even very recent scholarship demonstrating how pervasive unequal ecological exchange is, how it continues to be the case that the global south suffers net losses and drain of resources, materials, labor, energy, and money to the global north, right? So that pattern established in colonialism persists and has actually even intensified in recent decades. So it might feel correct to relocate the most extractive and harmful parts of the energy supply chain in the global north so that like we can pay, you know, our fair share of this extraction or bear that burden. But as Julie like beautifully just laid out at the end there, like who's the we, right? Who is subjected to this within the global north? Oh, well, actually look more closely and it happens to be that whether, you know, indigenous populations, whether racially, ethnically marginalized populations, whether other kinds of peripheries and sacrifice zones in the global north, that is where this gets cited, right? It's not, the extraction doesn't happen on Wall Street, like to make it really blunt and clear, right? It happens in places like indigenous territory in Nevada, right? Or in Europe, in Portugal, which is a place that within Europe is like, you know, a semi-periphery, we might say. So I guess just thinking more complexly and spatially about, you know, where things are cited within the global north, I think kind of betrays this narrative a little bit. And then just sort of a final point here, which is that there's no like technical fix to extractive harm. I think harm can be reduced. I'm not trying to say that harm can't be reduced, but it can't be reduced just merely by putting it somewhere else or merely by just changing the technologies of extraction. It requires something deeper, as your question, I think, kind of invites. And for me, it's all about, you know, the power relations and the political economy, right? So like, to again, kind of be blunt and simple, and this pertains anywhere in the global north or global south, which is that, you know, the more powerful a mining corporation is, the less scrutiny it has, the less regulation it has placed on it, the fewer constraints, the more powerful the repressive apparatus of the state in that context is, the worse it's going to be, the more harmful, right? In environmental, social, political, labor terms, whatever it is. The more powerful, on the flip side, what we might see as countervailing forces, like maybe parts of the state that have a positive function, like the regulatory apparatus or the social welfare apparatus. Or maybe we go directly to those movements and say the more powerful frontline movements are, the more they can make demands and say no to mining if they don't want it, or say it only happens under these conditions if they're okay with it, right? Like, I just think it's literally about, you know, who has power in that situation, and that will tell you a lot about who's bearing the harm and who's reaping the benefits. And the more those power relations can be calibrated to sort of lift up the most affected, I think the more you can actually limit the extent of extractive harm. And the very last thing I'll say here, to close out this unwieldy comment, is that to echo something that I think is a theme across our interventions here, which is that it's not just about the upstream extractive zones. It's also about what happens downstream. Julie mentioned recycling and sort of thinking about how these, the permanence of these materials and how we can think about how to make use of them. They don't just disappear. But you know, in addition to recycling and circular economy, there are just more and less resource intensive ways to design this transition. And those decisions often happen far away from extractive zones, but they inflect them, right? And so just kind of thinking about that as well in terms of what we advocate for as activists. Anyway, I'll leave it there.
I'll pick up by underscoring a point that Thea made in her previous response, which is that transnational coordination is key, really. If we're thinking about a global Green New Deal, right, initiatives are already underway. And there's a lot of, I'm really encouraged and fired up by the energy that I'm seeing in transnational grassroots and activist organizing that's strategically pulling in different members and aspects of the state apparatus across different countries into their causes. Of course, that's always fraught, but I'm really encouraged by what I'm seeing. And so I think that more continued transnational grassroots driven coordination for a Green New Deal is really important. I think that's the most important thing. The other thing I want to say, we've talked about some big ideas, fundamental assumptions, techno-optimism, and all of this in the time that we've had together tonight. The other thing that I wanted to emphasize is that the elements that we need, rare earth elements, not only are they not rare, but many of the other so-called critical or energy critical materials are not scarce. We are not running out of them. There are plenty within the earth's crust, including in so-called destination markets like the global north, which makes the whole proposition of onshoring possible in the first place. And so I emphasize that because if we can set aside this idea, right, that we're running out of everything that we need and that Earth is depleted and all of this stuff, we can then set aside a whole host of very problematic propositions about where and how and under what conditions we acquire the materials of our various possible futures, right? So if we set aside the idea, the belief, the catechism that these critical materials are scarce or rare, then we might quite easily and handily dismiss propositions to mine these things in biodiversity hotspots, to displace indigenous communities, fundamentally undermining their climate resilience, right, and their livelihood security. We can set aside propositions to, drill under retreating ice sheets in Greenland and elsewhere, even maybe to scrape up the ocean floor or to extract these things from the moon, right? and so I think, and I want to qualify that final thing just by saying, like, I'm not a cornucopianist. The struggles are real and distribution is constantly problematic, but we are not in a scenario of resource scarcity induced apocalypse. If anything, we're in a scenario of apocalypse induced by excess and poor coordination. So transnational organizing, locally and globally, that's the way to go.
That's an excellent note to leave off on. We have approximately 25 minutes left in this session. At this point, I would love to open it up to our audience. Please feel free to either raise your hand or simply let us see your face, put on your video, and feel free to pose a question to our guest today. Would anyone like to lead us off? Yes, Zabib.
Yeah, hello. I'm sorry for the background. I'm at the Regenstein Library right now. But I was very interested by y'all's points about transnational regulation and how that's needed because the apparatus of the nation state is quite constricted. And I guess I wanted you guys to be more explicit about the transnational organizations we have available to us and whether you think those are sufficient or if you believe there is like a need for reimagination and like new organizations to be made.
Great question. The short answer is no. I don't think they're sufficient. And I would think along two tracks. And I'm really curious what Julie has to say to this, but my kind of thinking is there, if those, let's say Bretton Woods, you know, and post-Bretton Woods institutions are going to serve us at all, which I'm not totally convinced of. But if they are, I think they need some major structural reforms. And lots of folks have written about this, and this is not a novel point, but it bears repeating that like the decision-making power within those institutions is pegged to the, you know, immediate post-war moment and the power holders and great powers at that moment. And that, you know, and so they're fundamentally undemocratic, and they're also anachronistic at the same time, and those reinforce one another. And so, you know, the countries most in need of the forms of redistribution, most deserving and meriting of that redistribution, are least empowered to adjudicate how it takes place, right? And I'm talking about the IMF and World Bank particularly, but we could extend this to other institutions. I think there's a lot of very valid critiques of the WTO and a double standard around things like industrial policy, right? Compared to, you know, the global North used all sorts of trade protections and patent violations in order to, quote, develop. And now the WTO restricts the global South from doing the same, right? So basically, if we're going to have those institutions, like those same buildings and the same names, like there needs to be a total reordering of power within them. So that would be one thing. But I also think that things can work on parallel tracks. And there are interesting proposals out there. Some of them are just really ideas, but that's how things sometimes start. Some of them might have a little more traction, but I'll give a couple of examples. So one is that, and a potential incoming president of Colombia, who is a left-wing candidate who's leading in the polls right now, former mayor of Bogota, has a proposal, if he were to become president, which we don't know yet, to form an anti-fossil fuel alliance among Latin American and maybe more broadly global South governments to say, like, kind of from below, I don't mean in the movement sense per se, but more in like the global hierarchy sense, we need to help, we need to direct this transition. We can't just be directed by it and left behind by it, right? So to kind of have some protagonism coming from quote unquote petrostates in the global South to say, like, we need, you know, we need redistribution. We can't just be left behind by an energy transition, but also we need to lead the charge against these oil companies that have devastated us, right? And so that's an interesting idea. There have also been periodically, but they haven't totally gelled into like a more institutionalized form, coordinated calls by global South governments around debt cancellation, which I think, again, that could take a little bit more of an institutional form. And then there's similar calls, you know, every COP, of course, there's some coordination around climate redistribution of climate financing. But yeah, I think it's a mix of, you know, the inside-outside strategy. It's a mix of pushing for governance reforms within the existing institutions, but also just forming new ones, because those are dated and they are maybe just too inflected with the neo-colonial world order that gave birth to them.
And that was an excellent question. My short answer is our international and transnational institutions are always inadequate. And even if the things that the ideas that Thea put forth should come to pass, they will still be inadequate. And I say that, though, as a reason to like opt in, right, as opposed to walking away from the project, because the challenges we face are daunting and many, it takes all of our best effort working in solidarity and examining and working to improve ourselves and our practices and our understandings along the way. I'll just say personally, you know, I'm doing my best to walk the walk. I'm a member of the technical committee for the International Standards Organization to develop transparency, traceability, and sustainability standards for the rare earth sector. Now, this is an organization that comes up with standards that, you know, companies can choose to adopt or not, countries can choose to adopt or not. You know, there's some very polite asking that goes on. But it is one of the very few places where you have members from otherwise, you know, countries that are at geopolitical odds with each other sitting down around the table and problem solving. And so the institution's inadequate, but it's also profoundly meaningful that it's there. And I think the same can be said for a number of institutions and transnational movements. They're always going to be inadequate. And I think that's the reason to love them more and give them more of your time.
Fredrik, please.
Thanks so much for a fantastic conversation. I've been typing frantically the whole time. So I'll ask a simple question. What sort of long-term goals should guide a transition to a post-carbon world? I mean, I'm getting a lot of bits and pieces of this now, but I just if you think big about this, you know, and I'm reading a lot of utopians right now, Kim Stanley Robinson, Jason Hickel, and so forth, right? Take your pick. Where would you go with this?
That's a fantastic question. And the reason I'm pausing, and I can see Thea's pondering as well, is, you know, I'm wondering how big should the answer be? And in my I actually want first to meditate on the hesitation. I think we know what our biggest answers are for the kind of world that we want, but I think we've been painfully socialized from even verbalizing them. Hence the hesitation. The kind of principles that I think should guide our transition to a post-carbon future, you know, our principles of justice, equity, the right of everyone to have access to beautiful, radiant things, to be safe in their person and in their context, in their homes. And I think that it says something about the ideological potency of our present context that those might feel trite to even say. And I guess I'll take this opportunity to invite reflection around that, that maybe we can challenge that, the self-censorship that we've internalized such that a basic question, a beautiful question about what kind of future we want, we're tempted almost to cut off its legs before it gets started, right? To dismiss it ourselves as utopian, even as we dare articulate the things that we want most to say.
Yeah, I like that a lot. And I do feel like this moment, even though, you know, I co-wrote a book about the Green New Deal and have organized political campaigns around it, it can feel so constraining. I mean, just like the news today, I mean, Ryan mentioned this at the outset, just like these reference points for where we are at, you know, year three of a pandemic, geopolitical tensions, highest that they've been in a minute, right? This sort of rush to defend the security and the sovereignty of like fossil fuels above all else as like the only haven of safety in this world. I mean, just like a feeling of regression that is very oppressing to me personally. And so I take Julie's point very personally. I mean, I hear what you're saying. I think that, you know, thinking about it a moment and thinking while Julie was talking, another answer that I might have that's also kind of like Julie's, maybe more of like an invitation than it is like an answer to the question. Something that I want to hold on to, but also sometimes does feel a little bit trite or overly optimistic or something, but anyway, that I want to retain is just this idea that has come up a couple of times today, but that, you know, the urgent need to eliminate carbon emissions and to leave fossil fuels in the ground and also to repair, you know, the environmental harm that has already been caused. That urgency, what I want it to do is to be like a portal to a really different world. Like it's not just, again, about we change our energy system and we maintain as much as about the present as possible. We disturb as little our practices of consumption and production, the hierarchies, the modes of injustice, all of this, that we disturb that as little so that we can guarantee that we can do this one important thing, which is get carbon out of the system, right? This is kind of like, I think, the kind of technocratic liberal approach to climate politics, which is like the less we do, the more likely we'll achieve it. And I just really want to push back against that. I think the more we do, in a way, the more likely we'll achieve it, because we can create broader constituencies, inspire people with more enlivening visions, but also because, you know, one important lesson I do take from political science, as much as I critique my own discipline often, is that beginnings matter, right? Like the beginning, the foundations of a process carry a lot of causal weight in shaping it, right? This is kind of the idea of path dependency. And so I'm worried about like encoding the power relations of hundreds of years of fossil capitalism into the materiality of this next energy transition, rather than kind of using it as a moment to say, what if we just totally redesigned our transportation system while we're at it? Like, what if we just totally redesigned like urban planning and housing and the siting of these different activities and spheres of life while we're swapping, you know, renewables for fossil fuel, you know, or fossil fuels, you know, whatever, fossil fuel to renewable? Like, why don't we do these other things at the same time while we have this tremendous opening and opportunity? And also because we know that whatever we don't do now might have 100 years of life in it, right? Like these are, you know, how institutions kind of settle and sediment, and economic sectors and powers also settle and sediment. So I guess that's my pushback to my own feeling of kind of foreclosure in this moment, is just to kind of retain that, not that the climate crisis is an opportunity. I don't want to say that tragedy is an opportunity, but I do think the energy transition is an opportunity to do much more than the energy transition. And so that's my kind of thought, but it's such a good question that I think we should kind of keep asking ourselves maybe daily.
Thank you both. Thank you.
I think we have time for one, maybe two more questions. I'm going to turn it over to Neil Brenner.
Yeah, thank you so much, Thea and Julie, for brilliant panel, brilliant discussion. As you all know, part of what we're doing in CEGU is trying to think about how we study and teach on these issues for students, and we're generally, you know, in relation to the field and the field that we want to build looking to the future. So I just wanted to, it's a very open-ended question with just a little bit of time left, but I think, you know, I know that many in the room, all of us would love to hear your thoughts about just how should we do energy social science of energy, and in relation to, you know, all the kinds of things that we've been discussing. And I just invite, you know, whether you want to talk about a different conceptualization that might inform that work, a different methodological approach, a different normative agenda, or maybe several. I know that's a huge question, but we would certainly love to hear your thoughts specifically on those matters in relation to the work that we're trying to do here.
As someone that has tried to teach the politics of energy a few times, and also is supposed to again in the fall, I've thought a little bit about this, but I'm not always satisfied with my own answers. So I'm curious what Julie says, or what any of us would want to say to this question. I think one of the things that I teach undergraduates, so just to keep that in mind, like what some of my goals might be. So this is not about, you know, how to guide dissertations or whatever, but it's sort of just how to teach at an accessible level all of the things that we've been talking about. I think one, you know, the narrative that it's very obvious that, quote, civilization would just, you know, use the most powerful and dense forms of energy, and this sort of like what I see is this Whiggish history of energy, which is so there in like every pop history and even some non-pop, unfortunately, scholarly histories of energy, that it's like obvious that we would go from water mills to coal to oil to natural gas. And then it becomes very unobvious why would we want to go to less dense, more dispersed. I mean, that almost like creates, I think, a negative or critical reaction to the energy transition, which is another problem with it. But it's also just wrong, I mean, fundamentally, empirically. And I find that students might have a little of that narrative in their head, but it's not that hard to dislodge it by like getting into the contingency of those moments of transition, which I think is then very enlightening about our present, very contingent, very uncertain, very uneven moment of energy transition, right? Like we as humanity, whatever, I don't love to use that phrase, but just for now as shorthand, have lived through multiple energy transitions, and all of them were unexpected before they occurred. They were marked by all sorts of power struggles. They could have turned out differently. There were paths foreclosed and not taken. And I find that students are really drawn in by that like rich narrative of like the actual material history, and then can use that as a way to think through like, well, okay, then what does that mean about our current moment? It is not guaranteed that we'll transition to renewable energy. It needs to be fought for. There's gonna be, you know, veto powers of vested interests that prefer the old energy system, right? That it's all kind of a matter of political economy and then materiality and how those interplay with one another. And I think that is a lesson that they're ready for, but it's not what they walk into the room thinking, because of the ways that we've sort of narrativized the energy transition and how that seeps into pop culture, as Julie kind of showed us with some of those slides.
Thank you for this question. This is one of my favorite things to think about. Now, because, you know, for a while I was a bright-eyed, bushy-tailed young person wanting to do something, anything to help, you know, solve the most pressing issues of our time, or at the very least understand them. And I bounced around from different frameworks, you know, international relations, you name it. And then I found geography. And so I'm going to answer as a geographer, I guess, to say that basically the way that we go about grappling with these issues, with the most pressing global and local issues of our time, is to make a commitment to a place or the places in which they are unfolding. And this is a commitment that happens on multiple levels, right? The intellectual, personal, political. But also, when I say place, I mean place in the thickest, richest sense of the word. Right? There's what the place is called, but it's also its physical properties. And what I'm thinking with here, actually, in response to your question, Neil, I went and dug up a quote from a wonderful piece written by a whole bunch of physical and human geographers, lead author by Rebecca Lave, published in 2014, called Critical Physical Geography. And I'm just going to put the quote in the chat here so we can all enjoy it. And I find this really encapsulates nicely the mode and the method of doing work, of thinking, of being, and of teaching in the world. So you all can read it yourself. I don't need to read it out loud, but I think the key thing here is I think there are two key things here that I want to say. First, engaging and grappling intellectually, personally, politically, with the most pressing issues of our time doesn't necessarily mean that we need to go to someplace far, far away. If we have a rich, thick, critical geographical understanding of our place, of any place, then whatever patch of earth we're standing on or whatever building we're sitting in, you know, you can see in your mind's eye, not only its presence at multiple scales of physical geography, right? Down into the subsoils and so on. And of course, the human sedimentations and archaeological histories upon which we sit. But you also have a sense of it within planetary circuits of flows of commodities, people, ideas, and goods. And the electrifying intellectual and political and affective experience that happens when you have that sense of place, the beautiful thing about it is that that electrifying moment can happen anywhere. You really literally can be anywhere. And increasingly, this is like a tenet of what and how I teach. And the reason, right, the ethical imperative behind that is really that in order to address the climate crisis and all of the related crises folded up into that, sort of summed up in passive voices, the Anthropocene or what have you, in order to really address these, we have to start everywhere. The good news is there's a lot of us, right? So we can start where we're at. I'll end there.
Not seeing any more hands from the audience, so that may be a perfect place for us to close this evening. You know, again, on behalf of the Faculty Working Group on Environment, Geography, and Urbanization, I wanted to thank you all for joining us on this Thursday evening, on a snowy Thursday evening, in Chicago, but in particular, I want to thank our distinguished guests, Thea and Julie, for your brilliant comments throughout. I'm sure this is going to have a sort of lasting impact on our campus, the faculty initiative, and the students that we had gathered here today. So thank you so very much, and take care, everyone. Have a nice weekend.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you.